Well, good afternoon from the Henry Jackson Society here in London. We're going to debate the social unrest in Leicester of last year. Diversity is a beautiful thing, a proud citizen of Leicester told the Guardian newspaper last year. He was marking the city's ascent to one of two cities celebrating diversity as the two most super diversity, I think is the jargon, cities in Britain with communal harmony, not anymore. Both as summer turned to autumn last year, hundreds of Muslim and Hindu youths were fighting each other on the streets of Leicester. Both sides are alleged to have engaged in inflammatory marches, social media, and disinformation. Masked Hindu men were allegedly armed with metal poles, marching through the Golden Mile, chanting Jai Shri Ram. And for their part, hundreds of Muslims descended on Leicester from outside the city, apparently with the intention of fighting Hindus. I say apparently because it seems to me to be hugely contested. So everything I say is pretty much everything is caveated, and please don't take it out on me. I'm just trying to be as balanced as I can be. Inevitably, counterclaims have followed claims and so on and so on. All this is a tragic echo of the long drawn out dispute between Pakistani aligned Muslims and Indian aligned Hindus over the disputed territory of Kashmir. So what are the facts behind the Leicester unrest? And critically, do they presage communal strife here to stay? And is it likely to escalate? The government has launched an independent review, but this lunchtime we're going to try and get ahead of that by me questioning two researchers who believe they've got the answers. First off is Charlotte Littlewood, a research fellow here at the Henry Jackson Society. Before she came here, she was several things, but critically a counter-extremism coordinator for an East London borough. Last November, Henry Jackson published her report, Hindu-Muslim Civil Unrest in Leicester, Hindutva and the Creation of a False Narrative. With Charlotte is a Prasida Sadaka, joining us from, I believe, Canada. Hello, Prasida.
Hello.
The author of a report, How Social Media Became a Weapon for Violence in the Leicester Unrest. Prasida is an analyst at the Network Contagion Research Institute at Carnegie Mellon University, which I think is in Pittsburgh. Prasida broadly arrived, I think I'm right in saying, broadly arrived at the same conclusions as Charlotte, although she took the story, I believe, on a little bit more because she did a lot of work on social media. So given that the two of you are broadly aligned, Charlotte, why don't you kick off and summarize your own findings from Leicester as to who did what and what the unrest was all about?
Well, I think the unrest in Leicester really came to the public attention at the time of the Queen's funeral. And that's when I was sort of first alerted to there being any issues. So it really was a project then of looking back in time and seeing what had led to the outbreak of the unrest and the marches in particular. So for me, the kind of key questions I had was, what is the tension between Hindus and Muslims in Leicester? Where is that coming from? And who organized both marches? So sort of in a nutshell, what I found in what was an express and deep dive into the unrest was that there had been violence between both Hindus and Muslims, reciprocal attacks that seemed to have anti-Muslim prejudice and anti-Hindu prejudice behind them between the youth. And there was also at the same time an issue around festivals, Hindu festivals, and just Hindu presence in what was traditionally seen as a more of a Muslim area. So when I spoke to those that were living in that area where there'd been a demographic shift, I spoke to both Hindu families.
Hindu migrants, you mean?
Hindu migrants had moved into what was considered to be
a more recently arrived than Muslim citizens.
Yeah, more recent arrivals. And I spoke to the residents on that street, both Hindus and Muslims, and found that there was a concern among some of the Muslim community about the noise of Hindu festivals and about the changes in their neighbours and the demographic changes. And there was a concern amongst the Hindu residents on that street that they weren't able to have their festivals. And they were very concerned. One of the things they thought I might've been a police officer. Right. So it was, we were not doing anything wrong with these Hindu festivals. So in a nutshell, I think there was violence on both sides. There was issues around festivals and social behavior was brought up, and a sense that the Leicester was changing. And there was a pushback from members of the Muslim community against the Hindu community around this. And there were attacks on festivals and there were attacks on vehicles and cars before the marches. And this Hindu group decided to march in favour of staying in their area where they lived, and for a sort of a peaceful living situation.
All right. The Muslim, if I can put it like this, narrative is that the Hindu community was being antisocial, getting drunk, making a lot of noise, that sort of thing. That obviously doesn't justify violence, but is there some truth in that, as far as you could see?
I think there was, from me speaking to people on the streets, and I think that from their claims, and I did believe their claims, and so I do understand that there were festivals
that
were
going on. Muslim.
Yeah. I spoke to a woman who had kids who was living on that street, who said that there were people drinking in the street, and it was concerning her. And so she'd spoken to other members of the Muslim community about this, and then there was the claim by Majid Freeman that he'd gone and sorted it out, and now there wasn't any more noise complaints.
But underlying, because we want to get to the main issue, don't we? We've only got an hour. Underlying all this was the suggestion from the Muslim side that underlying all this was, in fact, a sort of Hindutva political agenda, which was to, as it were, put the Muslim community in their place, if you like.
Yeah.
Did you find any evidence for that?
Not in Leicester. So
let's just stick to Leicester for the moment. Yeah. It sounds like you found it somewhere else. But why are you so confident of that? And the reason I ask you is because it is true, isn't it, that the I think on one occasion at least the Hindu side were marching, chanting, which I know is a dispute, is seen by Muslims as a rallying cry. I know that's not how Hindus see it. It's a private victory and so on. But as I say, everything's contested. But I mean, if that is the case, that's quite provocative, isn't it?
So I think we're dealing with a communal issue and a territorial communal issue and community breakdown. And I think naturally both communities chanted the slogan that's associated with their communities. Now, I see that you could say that there is communal nationalism in both of those chants, in Allahu Akbar and Jai Shri Ram.
Sure.
But whether there is organized Hindutva extremism, Hindutva terrorists, RS terrorists, as was claimed, which is what really brought the threat against the Hindu community and what then perpetuated in the media, that is what I heavily contest. I absolutely think that there is anti-Hindu and anti-Muslim hate going on in Leicester in a very kind of gang-like youth gang sort of scenario. But organised, backed by foreign backers as well, was another claim. Organised and backed by India, no, I don't think so.
Well, let's turn to Proceda for that, because Proceda, what about this allegation that a lot of this was being inflamed by social media from India itself? You did a little bit of work on that, didn't you? What's the evidence for that?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm happy to answer that. So first of all, thank you again for inviting me. So with the role of foreign interference, I think the answer is kind of very clear. So just a little bit of background on the kind of investigation that the NCRI conducted. What we did was really digital forensics into looking at the entire cyber social domain during the entirety of the Leicester unrest. So looking at the data across Twitter, across Instagram, TikTok, YouTube, and several other platforms.
Yeah.
The role of foreign interference is something that we are very used to identifying. In fact, we had just reported on another Iranian influence operation just a few months prior to this entire Leicester unrest. So what we had seen is that no specific foreign influence operations were actually detected during the Leicester unrest. So what this means is that there were no, let's say, coordinated activity from Indian accounts during the unrest itself. But that being said, one of the methodologies that we used in our research was looking into sentiment analysis using Google's Perspective API, which basically tells us scores for whether a tweet is toxic, threatening, harmful, has identity attacks, and so on and so forth. And what we did is we saw that there was a rise in tweets with identity attacks following the violence that had taken place. And what we did from those tweets that had identity attacks is we classified the top 500 tweets with the most engagement on identity attacks. And what we saw is that most of the blame for the violence was cast on Muslims as being the aggressors. And this blame was cast in India.
And yeah, hang on. You mean Hindus in India were blaming Muslims? That's not surprising, is it?
Well, we didn't say Hindus from India. What we did is we looked at the locations of who was casting blame, and we saw that accounts from India were casting blame on Muslims. So we didn't do any further classification on their religious right. identity.
But let me just ask you this quickly. One of the allegations made, it's true, by one of the Islamist organizations, I forget which one, Islam 21C, Five Pillars, Men, whatever, was that there was state involvement. I assume they mean Indian state involvement, not British UK state involvement. Did you find any evidence of the Indian government's hand behind stoking any of this?
Yes. So what we saw is that, actually, to answer the question, the answer is no, we didn't see that. But I do know what they're referring to. There was a piece that had come out in the Daily Mail suggesting that BJP was actually responsible for the unrest. And
that was an unnamed security source, if I recall.
Yeah, I was asked to find that and couldn't find it.
Unnamed. What does that mean? That doesn't mean anything.
Yes. And what I will say is from the cyber social domain, we didn't see any examples or evidence of foreign interference.
Okay. All right. So Charlotte, cutting to the chase, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but are you suggesting that whilst there was provocation from both sides, principle provocation, political capital out of it was the Muslim side? Is that your conclusion?
In the UK. So I think that once there was a recognised upset in Leicester in the communities, that was then started to be painted with this Hindu folk extremism, BJP, RSS. That became an orchestrated campaign of quite well-known Muslim activists, the likes of Majid Freeman, Mohammed Hijab, Riaz Khan, the likes that get involved in a lot of the other rallies.
But in fairness, were they acting?
There was someone who was clearly gang-linked, when Khan, who was the one sending messages and messaging groups and using his Instagram, which had 150,000 followers at the time before he took it down, to get people to move from Birmingham to Leicester. And it's within his private messaging groups that we have a whole wealth of evidence that wasn't allowed to go in here. So I have private messaging group messages and Facebook messages and Instagram screenshots of stuff that was then pulled that didn't make the evidence barrier to go in this report. So available if anyone needs it. But there were messages around, we need to chop them up and chase them out of Leicester, like we chased them out of Kashmir. Carpooling messages and organisation to get to Leicester. So I think they were probably the key groups. And there were a few groups doing that and individuals, including Norman Khan, that organised the protests. But what really worried me was the narrative that was created that this was Hindutva RSS extremism, especially on the run-up to the 2024 elections in India.
Narrative created by whom?
Created by our known friends.
Okay, but accepted by whom?
Accepted generally by the press was a real worry. So Majid Freeman managed to have a lot of contact with Channel 4 and the BBC and... the narrative that just pointed...
And they took him as a serious sort of person.
They did, yeah. So the narrative that it was Hindutva extremism sort of picked up. And if that wasn't the discussion, it was, let's just talk about India.
So instead of let's talk about what's happened here, which has been an attack on Hindu homes and families that may well have had nothing to do with the march. You know, there were cars that were attacked. And
but it's inevitable, isn't it, that any punch up between Muslims and Hindus in the UK is always likely to morph into a question about the communal strife being, as it were, imported, the Indian communal strife being imported into Britain.
I just think that's quite unfair.
Right.
When you look at the integration of Hindu communities into the UK, and the discussion should have been about what we were actually seeing in Leicester and not pointing to India and communal issues in India, because that suggests that we have a large scale problem in the UK with communal fighting, which I don't think we do, and I don't think that's fair.
Right. Proceeded. Do you share that this Charlotte's view that essentially the Leicester issue was isolated? Because I want to come on to whether, you know, the extent, and I'm making no comment on this, because I don't know the answer, the extent to which Hindutva extremism, quote unquote, exists in the UK widely. But Charlotte's making the point that this was not the issue, the driving force in Leicester. It was essentially about it, anyway, the trigger was, you know, antisocial behaviour and all that sort of thing. Do you see Leicester as it were, hermetically sealed from whatever's going on in the rest of the country in terms of the politicisation of Hindu ideology, if you like?
Yes, I do think it is that, but I think it also pertains to a larger question about how social media was weaponized through this entire Leicester unrest. Because if you actually take a look at where exactly this violence had originated, while there may have been some kind of ethnic tensions between communities in Leicester that existed prior to the cricket match that occurred in August, when we take a look at the social media data, we don't see a lot of, let's say, infighting or Twitter trolling between these two groups. But what really sparked this was that this idea of Hindutva was responsible for the clashes in the cricket match, which frankly, regularly occur between various groups, not just between Indian and Pakistani cricket fans. Oh. And that how this Hindutva is actually responsible and how Hindutva is being brought into the UK, and that Muslims need to call for a violent retaliation. What we see is that this kind of narrative is the one that's kind of dominant right after the August cricket match. And one thing that we had noticed, which had not been picked up by other media outlets, is how all of these tweets that had called for violence have since been deleted. We had used the Web Archive API to actually recover them. And what we see is that a lot of these accounts that are calling for retaliation, saying that, hey guys, look, Hindutva is responsible, we need to now retaliate, and how that kind of fomented into something even worse, where, like Charlotte had pointed out, influencers with over 150,000 followers are saying, hey, we're gonna meet up here, let's all go to Leicester, let's carpool, let's go together, see you later, boys, all of these types of tweets. And then the next day, we actually see violent unrest that takes place.
That's interesting. So I guess you'd see that as an attempt to rewrite history, as it were, the deleting, I mean, the mass deletions. And
yes.
It was mass, was it? I mean, we're talking thousands and thousands of deletions, are we? Or what are we talking about?
I wouldn't say thousands of deletions. I would say that the tweets that had the most engagement after the initial cricket match. So I would say a sample of not more than, like, I would say 10, 15 tweets that had since been deleted, but it doesn't matter about those 10, 15. It's about the engagement that those tweets had gotten.
Moving on, I mean, so let's, for the moment, park Leicester. I don't think we're ever going to resolve exactly forensically who triggered what. Well, no, you probably can, but I mean, who was principally behind it, as it were. It's so contested. The rest of the country, I mean, Hindu extremism, as with Irish extremism, as with Sikh extremism, it does exist, doesn't it? I mean, it's not as if this is a totally saintly.
I do want to ask that question, but you entertained a new question at the beginning of your question, John. Oh. When you said it's so contested, we're never going to get to the bottom of it.
Ah.
Because I think we will.
Okay.
And I think
Who's we? The government review or?
Well, I think this report, Pasita's report, forthcoming reports, we'll get to the bottom of it. Yeah. Because
But your critics would say you only spent a couple of days there or 3 days or something, and it's going to take a lot longer to to do.
But it depends on the question. Study. It depends on the question. If the question is who organized the marches and what affiliation did the organizers of the marches have, mm-hmm. I have answered that question. Mm-hmm. And that the answer to that question is those that were organizing the Hindu march were a group of about four or five men from Deodarman background, aged between 20 and 30, no, 18 and 25, like late teens, early 20s, who showed me their stab wounds and showed me their police reports, were living outside of their home, still within the wider.
That was a contested area, wasn't it? You did claim they moved out of their home. The police are reported, I'm saying reported as having said that isn't true, but what is the, what as you understand it, is the position?
Well, I mean, I think this really speaks to what was going on with people trying to look at Leicester. Right. Because I met those boys outside of their home.
Yeah.
I met three in their temporary residence. I interviewed them and I have their interviews are in here, where they say that not just them, but family members as well had spent time living in their work offices, had spent time sleeping in their cars, in hotels for fear of going back to their homes. On all of this evidence, the BBC journalist who interviewed me for her article, she had all of that evidence. Really? I sent her the transcripts of the interviews. I sent her the police reports in which the report...
Why didn't include that?
No, and she had the police report. The police report.
Okay.
Yeah.
But
saying is the Hindu Deodarman young boys that organised that march, I can tell you without shadow of a doubt that they didn't have any connections to the RSS or HSS in Leicester, which was one of the accusations. They were claimed to be Hindutva terrorists, RSS thugs.
Well, how can you be sure they didn't have? I'm not suggesting they do, but how do you know they didn't have any connection to RSS or HSS or? Did you just take their word for it? Go into their backgrounds?
We looked into who they were and what their role is in Leicester and what kind of members of the community they are. So there are young boys that were, some of them were having difficulties with work. They had poor English language skills. They were within a more relatively recent community that had come to the UK. They couldn't pronounce RSS. They said RRS. They had very, very little understanding of politics at all. They were involved in sort of factory work and in and out of work and struggling and young families.
Okay.
And knew the Muslim community from playing football with them on a community sort of level.
Right.
And it said they got on quite well with them for a while until there had been issues around their festivals and they got into fighting with each other. And that had then become quite territorial. And I could see by the fact that he had a stab wound. And
but when you say stab, I mean, there are stab wounds and stab wounds. Were these scratches or were these... deep wounds?
They just had two or three stitches on his arm.
Are they okay? They've been treated in hospital.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. I don't want to make any kind of accusation, but my sense is that they were involved in both, maybe involved in the gang sort of violence that was going on, but that hasn't been finalized by the police, so we don't know exactly their involvement. But that would be my concern. So I didn't see, anyway, a political affiliation or involvement. I did see anti-Muslim prejudice and anti-Hindu prejudice from the other side.
Yeah.
And so you asked then about wider Hindu extremism in the UK.
Hmm.
And I will answer that question. But I find it interesting that when we're looking at those that are involved with sympathizing for terrorism and those that are linked to a potential terrorist, we don't end up talking about them, but we keep coming back to, is there Hindu extremism in the UK? So to answer that, I'm not sure how we should define Hindu extremism, but there is definitely an element of anti-Muslim prejudice within sections.
Well, I mean, I'll give you an example, but I mean, I take your point, and we've got to be forensic about Leicester, but I'll just, I mean, there clearly is some Hindu extremism. I mean, the ITV in 2015 had a program, they had secret cameras, I think members of the HSS charity saying things like the number of good Muslims can be counted on fingers, the world's worst religion is Islam and so on. That's pretty cool. Now, you know, it's a few people, but that's, you know, pretty.
Yeah, I've absolutely seen anti-Muslim comments. I've seen and heard anti-Muslim statements being made by sections of the Hindu community. And I would say that they are not the young boys that were in Leicester. There's a different section of the community that there
are and should be concerns around potential cohesion issues. And that's something that should be addressed. But I think conflating it with Leicester and conflating with what was predominantly an Islamist attack on Hindus in Leicester, look, just pulling at straws, trying to find anti-Muslim bigotry in sections of the Hindu community as a result of this, it, in some ways I find is unfair. It's there. There is a cohesion issue. But is this what we should be speaking about when we're looking at Leicester? I don't think so.
Well, just to balance it up, I mean, I did look at some of the comments made by some of the more active Islamist Five Pillars, Mend, Islam 21C and so on. I must say, I didn't think the comment from Five Pillars was particularly responsible. Quote, extremely difficult to stay calm because of the police. I don't think that's a particularly helpful comment from someone trying to damp down the violence. And I must say, there is an element of that, and probably there is in the Hindu side, but there is an element of that in the statements put out by the Islamists. You know, we're doing our best to prevent our followers from doing anything worse, but, you know, it may be just very difficult to stop them. And that's obviously very unhelpful in a situation like this. But, Prasida, what do you... I mean, the big question really is, even though this may have begun as a fight about territory and, you know, antisocial behavior and so on, it doesn't take much for this to blow up into a mirror of, as I say, communal strife in India. And isn't that the big risk here? That unless we're very, very forensic and very careful about who's to blame in Leicester, we do risk, escalating this unintentionally.
Well, I think the question here, kind of building off of Charlotte's point, is that what is the role that this played specifically in the Leicester unrest? And when we take a look at malicious narratives that targeted both the Hindu community and the Muslim community, we do see a very big difference. And the first is that when you take a look at anti-Hindu narratives that are present across the internet, what you see is that this is very concentrated amongst British Islamist sympathizing networks. And this is basically the predominant voice when we take a look at the anti-Hindu narratives. Whereas when you take a look at the anti-Muslim sentiment, what you really see is that this is ethnic reactivity well after the violence itself has taken place. And also we have created AI models that actually look at incitement to violence against various communities. And what we saw is that majority of violence was actually incited against the Hindu community. It was something like 70% of tweets actually were anti-Hindu that were classified as violent incitement using models which we have put out there. And also 30% of tweets were anti-Muslim in nature. And when you take a look at the terms like Hindu and Muslim across the internet, specifically looking at this Leicester issue, you see that Hindus are the ones that are blamed for the violence in its entirety, whereas Muslims are seen as the retaliators, and it's all alleged and we're not really sure if it happened. So I think the question really is that how have these Islamist mobs basically incited violence against Hindus? I think when we keep pivoting to questions like Hindu extremism, in this whole discussion, it kind of takes away from the main point, which is that this false idea of Hindu extremism is precisely why Islamist mobs were incited to take to basically go out against Hindu communities in Leicester. So I think that's an important point, is that this entire creation of a false narrative that there is foreign influence, that these BJP youth are here without any kind of evidence to point to that, I think that really is what has caused this unrest, along with the social media weaponization.
Okay, thank you very much. That's very interesting. Well, look, I think let's open it up to the floor, shall we? Anyone who's got a question, please, can you state your name and the organization you represent, if you do represent one? Charlotte and Prasada will do their best to answer your questions. Yes, sir.
Kapil Dudakia. Don't actually represent any particular organization, but I have previously been part of many Hindu organizations and also am a writer. I write articles and things like that. And I've been monitoring what's been going on as far as this is concerned.
But you're not from Leicester.
I'm not from Leicester, but but I'm from the UK.
Okay,
and I'm from that particular community. That's been with me as well.
Okay.
One of the things that I wanted to point out, and which is very important, very often we actually hear many, many words being thrown around, forensic, this and forensic that, and inverse extremism. Ask yourself a basic question before you actually go down that narrative. Where have you actually seen inverse extremism? Have you actually seen Hindus going out and about burning trains? Have you actually seen them bombing London buses or killing our soldiers? Have you actually seen them attacking?
No, no, okay.
No, you haven't. No. So please be careful. Just because the Islamists come up with terminology which is to demean the victims, which is us, don't fall for that trap. The Western woke civilization has fallen for this silly trap. You excuse the aggressors by actually victimizing the victims. In Leicester, they were traumatized. And then guess what happens? The same thing happens in Birmingham. Now, how did that happen? Hindus didn't do that. The Islamists actually went to Birmingham to create a violent narrative there.
Sorry, what are you talking about? I'm not sure. I'm not with you now. When?
They actually attack Hindus and...
Oh, yes, in Birmingham. Yes, yes, yes.
Which is
yes.
miles
Sorry, away. Yes, yes.
How did that happen? Hindus... Yeah. Didn't do that. They weren't marching.
And Birmingham, of course, shares the accolade with Leicester as being the second super diverse city in Britain.
It's really, I mean,
the majority of
London, Leicester, Birmingham, Manchester. These are diverse cities, and so on.
Yeah, but I think Birmingham and Leicester, especially.
But what I can say to you is that whenever any Western person begins to discuss these matters, if you fall for the false narrative of the aggressor, and then you use the term, we must balance. No, you must not balance. You must talk the truth. You must have the reality.
Well, I'm not falling for any narrative. I'm just asking questions. But I take your point. I take your point. But Charlotte, this is a beef you have, isn't it, about the media. You think the media were not sort of curious enough. isn't that one of your complaints?
I think I hear what
you mean by the media, by the way, because there's all kinds of media. There's alt media, mainstream media.
Yeah, I mean, I think first of all, like, I understand what Capel is saying, and there's a large extent to which I agree. I think what we must be careful of not doing, though, is getting into a sort of tit for tat of this group is worst. Therefore, this group should be the only one being looked at, and this group is better. Therefore, it goes without any investigation at all. I think we've got an issue where one group most definitely was involved in creating the risk and was instigating a lot of the violence. But there are elements to which there is prejudice held amongst some sections of the Hindu community. And I think, although that doesn't equate... It doesn't equate, and I'm not trying to equate. It doesn't equate, and it shouldn't be brought into the discussion at this stage. I know that, but we do have to agree that there is an issue there that may be cohesion related. And what I worry about with Leicester is because of the press, the way the press has constantly pointed to India or talked about Hindutva and Hindutva extremism, rather than talking about the attacks on the Hindu community in Leicester, and rather than hearing the Hindu voice. What I'm worried about is we will see a rise in the anti-Muslim sentiment within the Hindu community, because I feel like the Hindu community now feel aggrieved, not listened to, not respected, without protection. And I think the media will have a lot on their hands, essentially, if a lot of guilt, really, if we see a rise in extremism within the Hindu community, because to continue to point to Hindu extremism, Hindu for extremism, and India at a time when Hindus were attacked by Islamist extremists, you have a recipe there for radicalization itself. Lots of the media, Guardian, Channel 4, BBC, were working either with Majid Freeman and pointing to India and dismissing.
Working with Majid.
Having Majid Freeman, well, I would say Channel 4 worked with him because their researcher went out on a tour of Leicester with him.
Right. Does everybody know who Majid Freeman is? If not, you should probably explain.
Oh, Majid Freeman has given prayers for the Taliban, prayers to brothers of an ISIS fighter,
is considered to be a terrorist sympathizer, and was called out by the police numerous occasions during Leicester for spreading fake news. And he seemed to be the one that had access to the mayor. He seemed to be the one that had access to the first proposed independent investigation, which was then scrapped because of his connections. And it looks to be that he may well have connections to the investigation being done by SOAS. So he is...
It's just the monitoring group.
Yeah. There's
with
Chatham Bat.
Yeah, he's a pretty well-respected academic, isn't he?
From what I understand...
Oh, okay, well, perhaps you disagree, but...
I think it's Chatham Bat who has met with Majid Fiam and talked about Hindutva, or was someone else on the SOAS board of investigators. But yeah, that's my concern, is that he seems to have himself very well in with all those of influence, which is concerning for now.
So, it seems to me... I'm sorry, I'm going to... your social media sort of evidence seems pretty critical. Are you going to share it with the independent review set up by the government? I'm going to ask it, you know.
Sorry, John, you're breaking up, so some of your voice is muffled.
I'm sorry. I was going to say, it seems to me, I want to apologize for trying to bring friends. It does matter to people.
Sorry, John, still muffled. We can't hear you. A little bit, but not really.
Shall I get past that? I'm really close to the mic.
Okay, better.
I was going to say that it seems to me,
still gone. Your audio is like completely gone now.
Okay, we'll try and
put it tonight. Is this any better?
A little bit. Okay, I only heard a very little portion of that, but I'm going to assume you asked about sharing the social media data with the independent inquiry. And yes. And if that's the case, yes, absolutely. So all of the data that was collected in this process, we've made our lexicon very public. When we looked at all of the tweets specifically relating to Leicester. So we're more than happy to be sharing this data and make it public. And I also think that the main issue with this and how this kind of escalated to the point that it has with social media being weaponized and with tactics like cyber social swarming, which is using influencers and their followers to actually deploy en masse and create mass mobilizations, as we had seen in this Leicester case, the real issue is that there is no kind of a weather station that can monitor and leverage open source intelligence that actively monitors social media analytics and takes a look at how can we create preventative action as opposed to maybe looking at the issue after it has actually taken place. I know that during this unrest, our own analysts were monitoring Instagram at basically every hour to take a look at the various Instagram stories, posts, tweets, collecting everything before they got taken down, or if they were taken down, how can we recover that using open source tools like Web Archive API. And what we really feel is that government and civil society leaders, they have to work with organizations like ours that are actually looking into this data and looking into this publicly available data and how this has actually managed to create unrest between various communities. If you're speaking, John, sorry, we can't hear you at all.
of Leicester, which Muslims regard as their territory and effectively no-go area for non-Muslims? And is there any similarity among Hindus? Good question.
I don't have a microphone. We're just going to try one more.
Oh, great. Okay, it's gone blue. You can hear me? Okay.
You're hearing us.
I would really like to say no, but that wouldn't be true. So Majid Freeman went through Leicester saying this is a Muslim patrol, and he put that on social media. And when I interviewed women living in the area, you have this quote from one lady who was living in the area where the houses were attacked and cars were attacked. And she's talking about the festivals. God can hear you. You don't have to shout. Since 3 years now, ladies come to live here. This year, this other lady opened up opposite me and then next to me. Why do you need to have a festival so loud that goes on for 3 days, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock? Why? We've got to go to work. And that was one of a few comments that alluded to the fact that they felt like there were people from another community moving into an area and behaving in a way that they weren't happy with, which is, yeah, a very thorny issue. But that is what was being said, so it can't be denied.
I was going to ask a question. We hear a lot about the influences, principally some of the names Freeman and others you've mentioned. But as, and I think I'm right, I think it's, I hope no one disagrees with this, there is no such thing as the Muslim community. It's a very diverse group in the UK, very diverse. And I'm also at the risk of being pilloried, which I probably will be. Certainly, the likes of Majid Freeman, in my experience, doesn't speak for the majority of Muslims in this country. What is the connection between the influencers and the, as it were, ordinary members of ordinary Muslims in the territory, in the area opposite the Hindus?
I think it. The thing is, ordinary Muslims, if you want to put it like that, or Muslims that aren't interested in Majid Freeman, are therefore not interested in the whole narrative, and therefore you do not hear from them.
No.
So you get into this...
Did you get a sense of the connection between the two?
We watch the networks work with the groups online in the same way Priscilla did, that were large followings and large networks, and they managed to mobilise hundreds of people, and that is very concerning. But that... obviously doesn't represent the wider Muslim community or communities, I don't even like the word community, who will have nothing to do with this, will barely understand what this is about and will have no interest in this. But they're not the people that you have grabbing the microphone or trying to talk to the BBC reporter. So you end up in this situation where you think this is really, really representative because it's all you hear, because they're the only ones making a noise.
No, it was ever us. The moderates, as it were, have got other things to do with their lives.
I would also add here that I think the real issue is that with the kind of malicious narratives that were present across the internet really did stoke, let's say average people to go out into the streets and create the unrest that we had witnessed. So like, for example, creating this idea that a mosque was attacked or that people or children are being kidnapped or like women and elderly are being attacked by these so-called Hindu mobs, which never actually took place, where the police actually had to come out and clarify that this had never happened. It's this idea of creating fear to suggest that Hindus are attacking innocent people, that it actually caused a lot of people to want to come out and retaliate.
What about the role of the police? I mean, how do we assess their handling of this difficult situation? What do you think, Charlotte?
Well, I'm not an expert on policing, but I thought the way in which they were coming out on social media and very quickly saying where there was fake news was something I'd never witnessed before from the police. And the fact that the police were having to do something like that spoke to me of a very new and different kind of threat, one in which fake news was managing to mobilize people. Mm. And I think that's really, really useful. Priscilla just said that this people were duped as well. Like I'd like to not think that the hundreds that came were all involved in a false narrative and malicious narrative. I'd like to think they were persuaded by those who were setting the false narrative that they really did need to defend themselves from Lutfer. Mm. Otherwise, we really do have a really big problem. Mm. I think the police did something that was very unusual, but very useful and necessary. And it's probably created a new way in which the police will now behave going forwards, and where in which a part of their role will be to call out false narratives that can mobilize people.
Go ahead, Priscilla.
Oh, what I was also going to say is that we performed network analysis on all of the users that had been interacting the most during this entire Leicester unrest. And what we saw is that mostly Hindu accounts were tagging Leicester police and saying, look, this is happening. Look, Dutch Raja is posting this. He has over 150,000 followers. He is calling for action, calling from Birmingham to Leicester. Please take action. You see the police are being tagged left, right, and center. And what this poses a very unique challenge, because that means that police really have to take notes of everywhere where they are being tagged. What are the kind of messaging that's out there? And do they witness, let's say, people saying that we're going to gather in this specific location to instill violence against various communities? They need to take action and take a look at all of these issues and make note of it so that preventative action is there.
Yes. On the, how many arrests were there? Something like 50 odd? Is that right? Or were there more than that? Have you got a figure for that?
I can't remember.
You don't know the breakdown of arrests?
No, we don't know.
All right. And what about the local authority? How did they perform, do you think?
Not well. So we had the city mayor spending time speaking with Majid Freeman, and Majid Freeman said, so first of all, you had to tackle ISIS. Well, now you're going to tackle the Hindutva, aren't you? And you have the city mayor nodding along to this.
He's trying to make an equivalence between Hindutva and
ISIS. And that the threat of that draw in the UK. And, you know, it's really important to emphasize there has never been a Hindu terrorist attack in the UK.
In Britain, yeah.
No.
I know you don't want to go outside Leicester.
But there's not been a terrorist attack, a Hindu-driven ideological terrorist attack here in the UK. And it concerns me greatly that there is a possibility that Hindutva or Hindu extremism is now on the prevent channel pathway list.
Yeah. Did William Shawcross recommend that?
Absolutely not.
No.
Absolutely not. Who recommended that? I'm not sure.
Well, it's part of the channel program now, is it? Does everybody understand this? The prevent. Yeah.
So that means that this is something that prevent will be, if someone has a referral, they refer in someone as a Islamistic extremism, so possibly AQ, ISIS ideology, far right, mixed unclear ideologies, and now Hindu extremism apparently is on the list. I am looking into it, but what that says is that there is a legitimate concern that through the pathway of Hindu extremism, you could become a Hindu terrorist, because prevent is terrorism. It's not counter-extremism, it's terrorism. And unless there has been a Hindu terrorist attack in the UK, it is terrible form that has been put on the channel list of ideologies.
And this you would say, I assume, Charlotte, you would say, would you, that this is the Home Office pandering to...
I mean, it's one of two things. I couldn't get my head around it. When I first learned of this, I couldn't get my head around it. I thought, what are they doing? Has there been a Hindu terrorist attack that I don't know about? Or is there a threat of Hindu terrorism that I don't know about? And I spoke to various people that would know, and that, you know, that's not the case. So what else is it?
Is it that they want to prove that there is no threat of Hindu terrorism by putting Hindutva on this list and showing that there are no numbers? I thought, well, that's a very strange thing to go about doing. So it leaves me with the question, has this come from Leicester? Has police prevent or officials in Leicester asked for this to be added? And if that's the case, I would worry about the integrity of that question to the Home Office, being that we've seen an awful lot of infiltration and sympathy from Leicester councillors, Leicester City Mayor, and elements of sort of the Leicester frontline workers to the idea that there's Hindutva extremism. So it would worry me if that is where the call to the Home Office came from.
Okay, anyone got any questions? Yes, sir.
Thank you, Donna. I'm just a concerned citizen.
Sure.
I'm neither Indian or Muslim. Neither Indian or Muslim.
Okay, right.
So
sure.
I don't have. Me too. I think our Prime Minister and Scottish First Minister.
Right.
Obviously, there's going to be a disagreement somewhere. Is that going to be used by certain groups for their own agenda?
Well, that's a good question. You, basically, what do you mean? Because Rishi Sunak is Hindu and the Scottish guy, I've forgotten his name for a moment. Yes, sorry. No disrespect to the First Minister. Is Muslim, yeah. Oh, gosh. Who knows? One would hope not.
Yeah, but would they be warned more to keep their tones down as they have a disagreement? Because you are very well...
Gosh, I don't know. I say you'd hope not. And
well, if there's a question that would they be divided on communal lines? Is that what the question is?
No, they won't.
No, would it feed into their...
For Scotland and England, because of devolution and this will be used by certain groups.
I'm sure it will be used. Well, I can't believe, I hope, anyway, it wouldn't be used by these two gentlemen. They rise above that sort of thing. But I suspect you're right that there will be some groups who will... Find it hard not to mention it at some stage.
Yeah.
But
yeah. We've seen
people. I don't think it'll get a lot of traction, frankly.
Yeah.
Because it really is not.
Yeah, I mean, in the same way that we've seen with Leicester, people try and drive narratives that are divisive, that cause problems. People will be trying to drive narratives that cause problems around the identity of them both. And we've seen elements of that around Rishi Sunak. There's been attempts to try and pin him as related to the RSS. And but yeah, I would agree with John that they will rise above this. And what happened in Leicester happened because the narrative managed to reach disenfranchised youth who were having community issues, as it were, and had also far too much time on their hands. And there are a lot of economic and integration and community issues in Leicester that need a lot of time being picked apart and looked at. And Leicester needs a lot of support, an extra support with charitable support to youth. And there's so much that needs to be done to Leicester, but that's not what's going to happen with these leaders, be my answer.
Anyone else? Are we taking questions from Arisa?
Yeah, to look at this.
Can you just say who you are and what
my
you...
My name is Jay Sharp.
Yeah.
And I am staying independent.
Independent.
Where is it? I come from a Jain community and chair the pacifist. And what I find is that Hindu community has always been targeted for unnecessary, which made me sick.
Right.
Because I find that, you know, they're a peaceful community. If you look at the prison statistics in
UK, we're talking about the UK.
Yeah. Prison statistics in UK from different religion background, and you see how many Hindus are in prison. And that will reflect the truth of the reality.
Yes. No doubt you're right.
Jonathan, we should take something from online.
Yes, we should. Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't see this. Sorry. I'm so sorry. Let me have a look.
I think we had
okay.
Chris Batman.
Hang on one second. I don't think I've got any, have I?
I know we're at time.
Here we are. Hi,
so
it's
if
Tom.
People want to leave, they can.
Could you try moving your phone? Sorry. Okay. Prakash from online about whether there had been an increase in reports of antisocial behaviour in the build-up to the unrest. If not, what changed? Well, I think there had been, hadn't there?
There had been reports of antisocial behaviour, and there were also complaints that the police weren't quick enough to respond to noise complaints, and also not sure what to do with noise complaints. So that it comes into my recommendations about how much needs to be more police outreach to communities. The police need to explain antisocial behaviour and how the local authority deals with noise complaints and how noise complaints are issued, and all this kind of stuff, so that the communities don't feel like they need to take up their own action, if it were. But yeah, the Majid Freeman made the complaint, though, that there had been no more antisocial behaviour reports after he'd gone and made his presence known in the area.
Right.
He said, we walked through Green Lane Road area in Leicester this evening and spoke to the locals. Many said they've not had to call the police even once in the past week to complain about the usual antisocial behaviour. No more music playing loud at 3 a.m. Alhamdulillah.
Right.
Since the Muslims started making their presence known on the streets in this area, the troublemakers have disappeared.
That sounds like a threat.
Yes.
And that was before the marches. So this is the sort of thing that the marches were retaliating to.
Okay. Sida, we're going to wind this up a bit. Any concluding thoughts?
I really think that the biggest issue here, I know we've talked about various different topics of whether there was anything before, what kind of happened on the ground. And obviously, as a researcher who studies this online, I really would like to say that this is one of the most alarming cases of where social media has been weaponized to create unrest between communities. And I know Charlotte and I, we were talking about another idea that we had in future where we actually sit down and talk about all of the findings from the online space. And I would just like to say I'm more than happy to do that, to really go into what happened online and how this had actually created all these kind of false narratives, malicious narratives, and so on that impacted all communities.
Well, on that note, I'm going to come off the fence and say I agree. The social media, the great venomous destabilizer of our time, in my view. And it's a force for that. It's just awful. Anyway, because I'm old enough to remember what life is.
Yes, I really look forward to actually asking you a lot more questions about how you did your report, because I want to know how to do it myself. There's a really brilliant kind of analysis you did, and the ability to bring back tweets from the dead as well. I still don't know how to do that. So I will be speaking to you about that. And thank you, everyone in the room, for joining us today. As I said, the reports are here, actually, dotted around, I want to take them away with you, including NCRI's very useful online timeline, and that's fine, which I should say, I have it here. And the report, looking at sort of the private messaging that was going on, the more violent and explicit threats that didn't make it into the report are available if anyone needs them.
Okay, thank you very much, Priscilla.
Great, thank you everyone. Thank you for having me.